you can't look at me and know that I have a disability. I've actually found it really empowering to sort of lead with, this is who I am and this is a part of my identity. During college, I was relatively healthy, and it wasn't until about 6 months after college that I started to experience really bizarre symptoms that ultimately led to my narcolepsy diagnosis. I and other people with type 1 narcolepsy aren't able to produce the neurotransmitter orexin, which is the neurotransmitter responsible for maintaining the balance between sleep and wake. So type 1 narcolepsy I often describe as being like a light switch that is flickering instead of being on or off like it should be. When I was originally diagnosed, I'd actually just started to study for the MCAT. And just because it was such a big life change, I pretty quickly decided the MCAT can wait. I'm gonna focus on my health and sort of figuring out how to live with narcolepsy. As hard as narcolepsy made my day-to-day, it also gave me unique insight into what it's like to be a patient. It was probably about 6 months after I was diagnosed that I was like, you know what, I'm still gonna do this. And then came the question of, well, am I gonna talk about narcolepsy as part of my story? I sort of took a leap of faith and decided, you know, this is my story, I'm gonna own it, I'm gonna talk about it, and was really pleasantly surprised by the response to that from friends and family and also through the medical school application process. I was quite anxious about, you know, how do I manage my narcolepsy in medical school? The sort of most useful accommodations that I have for narcolepsy are having extra time to nap and rest during the day. In the period of time when I wasn't open about my narcolepsy, I felt a lot of shame about who I was with this diagnosis. And I think the decision to be open in a like very intentional way has kind of helped me like take my power back and be like, I am in charge of this narrative.